Macmillan Audio presents Let the Good Times Roll by Kenney Jones. Read for you by David John.
Hi, this is Kenney Jones. Thanks for choosing to listen to the story of my life so far. Over the years, I've thought about writing this book, but it never seemed to be quite the right moment. Now, as I approach my 70th birthday, I have decided the time has finally arrived. It's been an emotional journey, from reliving my days as a scallywag running around London's East End to obtaining my first drum kit and discovering the magic of drumming, from playing along to the only three records my dad had in the house. Setting off down that path eventually led me to perform and record with some of the world's greatest rock musicians. David Bowie, as David Jones as I knew him in those days, Rod Stewart, Pete Townsend, Joe Cocker, Jimmy Page, Mick Jagger, and Paul McCartney. I've been so blessed in my musical career, the list could go on and on. Throughout it all, there has been a great deal of laughter, plenty of mad antics, some bad behaviour, a lot of music, plus tears I've shed over those I have lost. I hope you enjoy the ride as much as I have.
Chapter 1. A right little Herbert. Nah, never heard of him. That would have been the response to anyone in the 1950s walking down Havering Street in London's East End, where I grew up, asking where Kenney Jones lived. Back then, I was known to my mates and everyone on the street as Kenny Ward. I was the only child of Violet Elizabeth Jones and Samuel Thomas Jones, born on the 16th of September 1948. We lived at number 34, with my mum's parents, Jane and William Ward. That terraced house in Stepney had been the Ward family home for, well, it seemed like forever. And although Kenneth Thomas Jones was my real name, no one ever thought of me as that. My grandparents were part of the furniture of Stepney, and very nearly ended up as part of the street itself. My grandfather used to tell the story of a bomb dropping at the bottom of Havering Street during the Blitz, down by Commercial Road, while he and my nan were in bed. I don't know why there wasn't an air raid siren, but obviously they woke up with the explosion. It was a very near miss. Not only did all the windows of their house shatter, but the blast was sufficiently strong also to blow in the bedroom window frame, which ended up hanging around their necks as they were sitting up, probably thinking this was it for them. I saw something similar happen many years later to a very angry man in a hotel lobby in Honolulu, although with a picture rather than a window frame. I thought it was a laugh. I'm sure my grandparents didn't find their experience at all amusing. Our house in Havering Street was the centre of the whole family. The Joneses and the Wards. A happy home, full of love and affection. My dad's parents also lived close by, across the road near Arbor Square, Nick, where I made my first public appearance. I'll get onto that in a moment. Mum always told me that it was Nan and Grandad who brought me up because she was too ill. She was always telling me she was ill, and while it's true she didn't always keep the best of health, she lived to the age of 89. I think I'm right in saying that she was among the first women in England to undergo a pioneering colostomy procedure, a big deal back then. I was 16 at the time and remember visiting her in hospital, telling her all about my hit record that had just come out. She was in the London Jewish Hospital on Stepney Green. Not that we're Jewish, but that, of course, didn't matter at all. People of all religions were cared for there. Mum was very well looked after. The hospital had originally been built to help meet the needs of the large Jewish community who were very much part of the fabric of the East End, many working in the garment industry, known as the rag trade, and contributing to the vivid character of the streets on which I played, and sometimes ran riot. One Jewish lady in particular stands out in my memory. Or more precisely, what she sold stands out. She ran a delicatessen on Cable Street, around the corner from us, where you could buy bread and dripping for a farthing. To serve you, she would tuck the loaf under her arm, dip her knife into the jar of dripping, slather it over the end of the bread, then slice off a massive doorstep. Brilliant. Right opposite that deli was another source of wonderful treats, the local fish and chip shop. Not that we could afford the fish, but that didn't matter. For a penny, you could walk out of that place with a bag of crackling, the scraps of batter that had fallen off the fish, or saveloys, or whatever was being cooked in the fryer. Better than boring old cod any day. Before illness restricted Mum's working life, she was an engraver and cutter for T&W Ide, a glass factory just off Cable Street, very near my school. The section where she worked was fronted by a large frosted window, embedded with wire mesh for security. This being the East End, though, nothing was entirely safe. Some urchin had shot at it with an air rifle, leaving a convenient peephole about the size of a sixpence, or a tanner as we knew it, for me to eyeball Mum and attract her attention with a shout of, "Can I have half a crown?" If she had anything in her purse, she would quickly duck round to the side door and slip the coin to me. She was good like that. Then I'd trot off to school, deciding what to spend it on. I don't think it would have been cigarettes then. This was in primary days. But I can't be sure. Dad was a lorry driver. He'd learned to drive trucks in the army during the war. And after being demobbed, he joined the firm J. Packers and Sons, based in Canning Town. In those days, it was a motor and trailer, not an Arctic as is common now. Dad drove and his mate looked after the trailer. The lorry cab housed a big engine covering, which I loved to sit on because it was warm and exciting. They used to take me on trips, long distance sometimes. And even then, long before I'd ever thought of becoming a drummer, I had the best seat in the house, sitting between the two of them, pretending to drive. I got on well with Dad. I loved him to bits. He was quiet, loving, and unassuming. But there was also a roguish element to him. I used to wonder what the hell was going on when, every now and again, he would come home, almost certainly after enjoying a few pints at the local, walk into the kitchen and throw a wad of cash into the air. It was such a sight. Notes back then were the size of a newspaper, and they used to float slowly and gently to the ground. I'm sure he was up to no good. That's probably how he managed to afford the various cars he bought over the years, including a fantastic Austin convertible, which he loved. I loved it too, even though I once suffered a burn on my leg in that car. Mum and Dad were both smokers, and one of them flicked a butt out when the top was down, and it flew back in, landing on me, squeezed in the back. There were only ever a handful of cars parked on Havering Street while I was growing up, and one of them would be Dad's. Ask no questions. That was the neighbourhood motto. Everyone understood that. Flamboyant gestures were unusual for my father, who was by nature a shy man, unless he'd been to the pub. Then, a more theatrical side of his personality would nudge itself to the surface. I recall arriving home from school to find Dad a little worse for wear after an afternoon with his mates, during which he'd concocted a plan to play a trick on Mum. He was clearly very pleased with himself, sitting there with a smile as wide as the Thames. "On you go, son," he said, gesturing towards the kitchen. "Take a look in the sink." I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Staring back at me was a pig's head, wearing a flat cap, or a cheese cutter, as they were called in the East End. This is going to be great. Just after 5 o'clock, Mum arrived home from her work at the glass factory. "Cup of tea, Sam?" Love one. Off she went to the kitchen, while Dad and I sat in the front room, desperately trying to suppress giggles as we waited for the big moment. Nothing. We could hear her putting groceries into the cupboard, taking out the biscuit tin, setting cups and saucers on the table, tidying up. Then, at last, she went to fill the kettle. Crash! It clattered to the floor as Mum started screaming like mad. She thought it was a human. We thought it was hilarious. Dad and I had a very similar sense of humour. We had a television at home, again, asked no questions. A massive thing with a tiny picture. It looked like an eyeball. And once, when a cowboy show came on, Dad said to me, "Have you noticed, son, how the horses never shit?" "Yeah, Dad, I have." "Ah, but have you ever looked behind the set?" That made me laugh for ages. Argentinian beef was a regular delivery for Dad. And sometimes, fairly often in fact, during his round, he would call into home for a cup of tea and drop off some goods for Mum. My father's brother, Uncle Jim, was a lorry driver as well. He delivered tea in big wooden chests. That was handy. Although we didn't have much money, we didn't want for much. Growing up, I lived off tea, Argentinian beef, and bananas, when available on the markets. That's what it was like in the East End. Most people either worked as drivers on the docks or on stalls. Bartering was a way of life. The Cray twins, the gangsters, were distant cousins on Dad's side. And I'm sure I must have come across them as a kid. But I wouldn't have paid them any special attention. Everyone around me was a rogue. Dad's driving mate, for instance, was father to Roy James, who went on to become one of the great train robbers. My cousin Billy Boy, eldest son of my dad's sister Nell and Uncle Bill, worked with the Crays. Billy Boy was a bit of a villain. I felt I was forever being dragged on buses and trains to Wormwood Scrubs to visit him when he was in the nick. It would never have occurred to Mum and Dad not to go and see him. They were Billy Boy's favourite aunt and uncle after all. Nor did they hesitate for a second about whether to take me along. Even if it was intimidating for a small lad to walk through those massive prison gates. We lived in a close-knit community, where family mattered. Values were different from those of today. When I was in my early teens, Billy Boy met this woman and broke out of prison to marry her. We all attended the wedding in a church just off Cable Street. Of course we did. We wouldn't have dreamt of missing such a happy event. Dad's family was Welsh. Not that he spoke the language or anything. He was an East End boy through and through. But his father was born in Wales, and all the family had Welsh names. As for me, I was named after my dad's best mate in the army, Kenneth. I always preferred Kenny. I only added the extra E when I was 16 and starting out in the small faces. I'd just become a member of the Performing Rights Society, PRS, which looks after the interests of musicians and songwriters. I thought joining the PRS was great, like I'd really made it. Then I began to receive letters and royalty checks for other people with similar names. Turned out there were about 5 Ken Joneses, a few Kenneth Joneses, and a number of Kenny Joneses. I contacted the PRS and suggested adding an E in my name to make the difference. It stuck. Our house on Havering Street is still there. The area hasn't suffered development because the street is listed. I don't think it's because of me. It's classic architecture. Although they were talking about putting up one of those plaques saying Kenny Jones lived here. Underneath, they'd probably have added, "So what?" Actually, there's now one in Carnaby Street for the small faces. It's green. That's important. It means I'm alive. It's blue if you're dead. for the Carnaby Street plaque. I suggested either turquoise or half and half blue and green, because at the time, two of the band were dead. They didn't go for it. I must confess, I like having that plaque. When they told me about it, I thought, oh, good, just like Nelson. Havering Street felt like our own little village, with its own identity, a good identity. A lot of East End streets were like that. The people there supported each other, looked out for each other, and occasionally knew a little more about each other than they might have liked. We all had outside toilets, and everyone knew when old man Bainham, the grandfather of our next door neighbours, had to go. Early morning, you'd hear him in there, coughing his guts up, waking half the street. I loved living in Havering Street with my parents. I felt comfortable and happy. I remained there well after I started enjoying success with the small faces. But once I did buy a place of my own, I didn't for a second miss that outside loo. The cold in winter made it a tortuous experience. Your bum would stick to the seat. Man, that was painful. Strange to think that by the end of the 1960s, millions of people watching Top of the Pops and other music shows had seen Steve Marriott step into that same Kazi, which featured in the Lazy Sunday video we made. So much for privacy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.